Next Sunday, hopefully everybody will remember that the Danville Christmas Walk, which has a lot of our own people involved in that program, it's next Sunday evening, December 4th at 5:30 at the Square. You can meet and then walk down Market Street, and they'll arrive in the park and have a lighting of the Christmas tree, probably about 5:45 or so, and there's a short program there with cookies, hot chocolate, and a tree lighting. So we hope you can be there for that. A new announcement for you, December 17th is an elementary movie night. We'll have more information in the bulletin next week. And then this evening, just a reminder, we have our Grief Share Surviving the Holidays program. For a number of years, we've hosted a Grief Share program here. It's a 13-week program where those who have lost loved ones come together and find support and encouragement from other people. And every year we discover the holidays are a particularly difficult time for those that have lost loved ones to death. And the program this evening will be a great opportunity if you've lost somebody recently or even over the years to gain a better understanding of how to process some of those emotions during the holiday season and how to deal with some of the more practical issues that arise during this time of year, like how to go to holiday parties without feeling just deep darkness, but to also go to those and enjoy time with friends and family and just interact with people the maybe the way you would want to. So we would invite you to be here tonight at 6:15. Everybody's invited to come. You can tell others about it. We'll start at 6:15. We've got a refreshment tray, so feel free to come and eat supper here. And then around 7 o'clock, we'll take a break. There will be the Lord's Supper this evening, and then we'll follow through with the rest of that program. There will not be our typical evening service. The kids will meet in here at 6 o'clock this evening to work on their Christmas program, though. And then starting next Sunday morning, December 4th, and then for the 2 weeks following, the 11th and the 18th, at 9:30 in the morning, if you're a new person to the church, if you've just placed your membership and baptized into Christ over the last few years, or you've been around for a long time and you just need that reminder of what we believe as a church, we're going to start a 3-week class next Sunday at 9:30 called What We Believe. We're going to use a book, 13 Basic Principles of Christian Doctrine. It's available here on the stage. You're welcome to grab one of those on your way out today. But again, if you're new to the church in any way, we invite you to be in here at 9:30 next Sunday morning. And then on December 9th, we have our Fire and Ice Christmas event. We do need volunteers for that, and you can sign up on the bulletin board. I want to share some prayer concerns with you and then some praises as well. Pray for Larry Snow. He was taken to the ER last night and has some issues related to his breathing. That's Larry Snow. And then pray for the situation with Mike and Brenda Walter's granddaughter, where she goes to school. There's some issues there regarding child safety. So again, that's a school in Wyoming that needs our prayers. A few cards here for you. First, thank you for the gift bag of food from the church. That's from Ernie Kaufman. He says, I'm very full. Or no, wait, he said, I'm very thankful. That was it. And then a thank you card here from Ed and Barb Rager. Ed and I thank all of you so much for the wonderful holiday bag of goodies we received. It's greatly appreciated. Also, thank you for the continued prayers for the health issues that they face. We love you folks here at the church at Millwood. May God bless all of you now and in the years to come. Again, that's Ed and Barb Rager. And then great news, we've been praying for Stephen Myers for a number of weeks, really months at this point. He's had serious health concerns. And Jim and Rachel Myers report that things are definitely looking good for him. We want to thank the church for all your prayers. It's comforting to know that the people are praying for you when you have a crisis in your family. We're praising God that Stephen was released to come home on Tuesday just in time to spend Thanksgiving with his family. He's gaining strength every day, and will continue with his therapy at home. Thank you all so much for your prayers. That's Jim and Rachel Myers. That is great news. And then we do need to keep in mind the Barb Heenan family. That's Julie's mom. They have her calling hours today and then a funeral this afternoon as well. Lots of people to be in prayer for, but also lots of things to give thanks to the Lord for. This morning, Zach will be preaching for us a little bit later in our service, and he's going to share a little bit about maybe dealing with some doubts. And I want to share with you about John the Baptist from Matthew chapter 3. Now, in those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is the one referred to by Isaiah the prophet when he said, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, make ready the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." John was a unique individual preaching in the wilderness, but he had confidence when he was preaching about who he was preaching for. He was preaching about Jesus. And he says, as Jesus arrives one day to be baptized, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And we have confidence that Jesus is the Lamb of God who came to take away the sin of the world as we worship him today. Let's stand together, have a prayer, and then we'll have a time of singing. Our God in heaven, we give you praise for today. You're a holy and a righteous God. You set forth a plan to redeem us even before we knew we needed redemption. And Father, we thank you for Jesus. He is that Lamb who takes away the sin of the world. Father, there are times in our lives where we might doubt and question the existence of God. We might go through difficult circumstances that cause us to wonder and to question our own faith. But Father, we know that you're a good and awesome God who loves us deeply. We thank you so much for the answered prayers that we've been able to participate in. And Father, we lift up to you those that are still struggling and going through difficult times, and we just count on your blessing in their lives, whatever the outcome may be, that Jesus Christ will be glorified. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Your tabernacle, glory to the Lord on high, God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are. Celebrate the light. When I stumble in the darkness, I will call your name by night. God of wonders beyond our galaxy. Your majesty, you are holy, holy, Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven and earth. mercy.
Give us pure hearts. Let
Let us not lift our souls to another, and God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Your face, O God of Jacob. We bow our hearts, we bend our knees. O Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. Cast down our idols. So give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Seeks your face, O God of Jacob. And God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, O God of Jacob. So
we come to our time of communion this morning, just finishing up the Thanksgiving holiday. I know that we all have a lot to be thankful for in this country as a very fortunate people that live here. And many things that we're thankful for among them was definitely the food that we're able to eat. And if there wasn't a lot of food, I want to talk to you today about something that will fill you up way more than any Thanksgiving meal that you could have ever had. In John chapter 6, Jesus says to his disciples, "I'm the bread of life. He who comes to me will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst." Jesus gave that promise to them, knowing that he was about to give up his life so that we might have life more abundantly in him. So among the things to be thankful for, we want to focus right now on Jesus and the sacrifice that was made on our behalf to be able to commune with him on every Lord's Day as the example is given to us, but also to be able to commune with him one day for eternity. And that's the hope that we have in him. Luke chapter 22 records that he took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we're thankful for the time that we can set aside to remember the gift that was given to us, the grace that is so richly poured out that we don't deserve. And God, we're so thankful for this time to be able to remember that Jesus went to that cross, that he was beaten, that his blood was shed. He was buried in a tomb. And God, we're so thankful that he rose again to allow us to have that hope that we too will rise again. So as we take these emblems today, help us focus on that. Help us focus on you. It's in your Son's name. Amen.
Thank you. And everyone. My wife and I, when we went on our honeymoon in April, we went to Tennessee, and we were pretty close to Gatlinburg area, but we didn't want to be in Gatlinburg. I personally find that I personally find that nature is better when there's not as many people there. So we went to a place that's close to Gatlinburg Park, which is where Smoky Mountain Park is. And we were fairly close. I can't pronounce the name of the place we were actually at. but we were about 20 minutes away from there, and we would go in periodically through Gatlinburg, which is the entrance to the Smoky Mountain Park there. And there was some beautiful hiking there, and we'd go, and every other day or so, we'd find a different trail to hike. And on one day, we were just driving through the mountains. If you've ever been in that area, you know, it takes you a long time, really, to get anywhere. We're just driving through the mountains, and we see all these cars parked. And it's Alum Cave Trail, so it's apparently a pretty quick and easy trail. It was only a few miles, so we pull over, we go down. Being a quicker trail, we didn't really pack for this trip. So we have a little pack. We might have a Kind Bar, a Cliff Bar, a little baggie of grapes. I have half a bottle of water. She's got a bottle of water. And that's it in our trekking poles, and we go to Alum Cave. Well, it was all right, but there were so many people. There was a pretty easy trail, so there's a lot of people, overcrowded. You don't really get to see the view and appreciate it for what it is. But we started seeing some people coming down. If we're looking out towards the mountain range, we see people coming down to our right, and it's the entrance or the trailhead to Mount LeConte. So Mount LeConte is a fairly large mountain for that range, and we didn't know that. Here's a few things about Mount LeConte that we didn't know before we decided to go down this trail. It is the third highest mountain in the whole Smoky Range, the highest in the Tennessee side. 75 to 80% of people who attempt the trail turn back before they reach the top. There are parts that are dense forest, large rocks you have to climb. There are places on side of the mountain that are only 12 inches wide, and the only thing that keeps you from falling over is a little cable that they have tied to the side of the mountain, and while the wind's blowing you around, you hold onto that cable and walk. There are parts of that trail where the rock or mud, whatever it was, I don't remember in that specific area now, had actually washed out, and you had the trail was even more narrow than it was before. So here we are, Alum Cave, not knowing anything about Mount LeConte, underpacked, and we're faced at this trailhead, and we don't have enough time to go back to our car and get gear, and that week that we had is starting to dwindle down. So if we want to do this trail, we have to do it now, underpacked, not prepared, unknowing what would be there. And sure enough, actually what motivated us is there was an old man that walked down the trail, and he was old, okay? He was old. And he comes down the trail, and we're thinking, if he can do it, we can do it. So we shouldn't have had that mentality, because let me tell you, Mount LeConte, about halfway, at this point, I'm out of water, and I am trying to get water that's coming off the springs, filtering through moss, and it's... Yeah, you know, you're like, oh, spring water, that's the best. Spring water through a clear bottle, still it doesn't look very pretty. But it tastes kind of like water and mud and moss and stuff. But it was water enough, right? I was thirsty. I was desperate. I go up there, and we're doing that. You know, like, I'm not fat, but I like food. And I ate all my food before we got to the top. I'm hungry. I'm thirsty. She's still doing fine. When she's not looking, I'm sneaking a little bit of her water here and there. It was not a good trip. It was not a good trip. And after hours and hours, I think it was three and a half hours on the way up, and then you imagine the same down, we make it to the top, and they have a picture of what that looks like. We make it to the top, and here we are, the tallest mountain in Tennessee. And we can see all the mountains behind us. And the way this works, it's just a giant rock, and it kind of goes down to the cliff. And it was real windy that day, so I wasn't getting near the edge of the cliff. So we took the picture here. And you could see everything. And despite being thirsty, being tired, rolling our ankles who knows how many times, having to climb over the wet, mossy rocks and be cold and damp, and all the things that go with camping or with hiking, we got up there, and it was all worth it. We all come into trailheads in our life. We meet one at every choice we have to make. Every time we have to make a choice, we are faced with the trailhead. Do I go here? Do I go there? And I think there are choices in our life where God really probably doesn't have much of an opinion and whether or not we do something. Example, I don't think God really cares if we go hiking or if we don't go hiking. But I think there are other areas where God and these trailheads, where God really does care about the choices we make. Who do we marry? Things like our education, the education of our children, how we steward our finances and what we do with our family. How do we develop our spiritual life? There are trailheads in our life, specifically towards discipleship, where I think God cares what path we choose on the trailhead. So I think there's things that God really doesn't care about, and I think there are things that God really does care about. So there are things that directly affect our relationship with God and other things that don't necessarily. So let's think of a house. Is a house a bad thing? Absolutely not. So do you think God will give you a house or give you a place to live? Sure. But do you think God really cares whether the siding is white or blue? Probably not. See, God tends to care about the things. He tends to satisfy our needs rather than our individual desires. How about a job? Is a job a bad thing? No. But how about a job that makes you work so many hours that you have no time to spend with the church or your family? Now, is that job a bad thing? Absolutely so. There are some things that have potential to grow us in our faith, and there are other things that can deter us from our faith. And I think that God cares about those things that actually grow our faith or deter our faith, not necessarily the things like what color car or what color siding. And think about this. If God truly exists, and we all believe God exists, but if God truly exists, your faith is the most important possession you have to take care of. Everything else is really insignificant in that way. I like what Jeff Fall, who is going to be our 2023 revival speaker, says. He says, everything, to some degree, disciples us closer or further away from Jesus. Take a car, for example. God probably isn't going to, if you go to buy a car and you're like, God, I need a sign. I don't know what color car I want. Do I get the blue car? Do I get the red car? Do I get the black car? Do I get the white car? I don't think God really cares about the individual color of the car. Now, the only time God might say don't get the car is if it's a Chevy. But other than that, he's probably completely cool with whatever you get. But God does care about making sure that you can have transportation to provide for your family. God does care that you don't sink yourself into financial debt so that you can meet the needs you have in other areas. And even then, God can't put bumper guards in every area of our life. He can't divinely select every decision. Otherwise, there'd be no room for Christian to make choices and exercise their faith. See, if God forced everything to happen, if everything happens because God wills it to happen, not saying God doesn't have a part, but if God divinely judges and selects every single thing in your life to happen, where is there room for free will? Where is there room for spiritual maturity to make decisions? Why would we need the Bible if God decides everything for us? Well, obviously, we wouldn't. So I think God allows us to make decisions. And one of the things we're talking about is decision making with these trailheads that we're talking about. I believe God rarely cares about the details. I think God being eternal, infinite, is more worried about the significant issue at hand. I think God satisfies the needs and not always our wants. He might provide the place to live, but once again, he probably doesn't care about the color of the siding. And you also have to assume, maybe when we talk about God providing a house, we just bought a house and we're doing a remodel and it is awful. But we do appreciate everyone who has come out to help us work on it. I did not know that someone could have so many layers of flooring in a house. It is pretty incredible. Matter of fact, just a quick tangent. In our kitchen, first we took the tile up, then there were all the screws, and then the mortar had separated from the tile and the cement board, so we had to chisel the mortar up. And then we had to chisel the cement board up. And are we done? No, we're not done. Why would we be done? Then we have another layer of composite tile, and under that, asbestos flooring. And they also, it's been a roller coaster of fun. All kinds of things have gone on. Saying, that's not the, actually, I'll tell you another story. This one's actually funny. Sump pumps, right? In your basement, pumps up all the groundwater. And so that is something that's actually supposed to be ran out into your yard. Ours was ran into the sink drain. So when I cut the sink out, move that over, now I'm down in the basement. The water softener need replaced. It's full of water, probably 40 gallons of water. Where do I think I'm going to dump this? Because I can't carry it up the steps. In the sump pump. Turns on. Where do you think this water goes? Now, I can't make the scream that Emily makes. But if I had to try, it'd be something like this. What? What's going on? There's water everywhere. I go up there. It's pumping up all this gray water all over the asbestos flooring. And it smells disgusting. That's a surprise. I don't know how I told you about that surprise, but we're going to get back to the Bible now. That's a surprise. Talking about a home, right? Is a home really a necessity? And I think God wants us to have a home, and I think that's the ideal situation. Matter of fact, when God talks about having a celestial body, whatever that looks like, he says, I go and I prepare a place for you. Right? So God wants us to have some sort of home, and in heaven we know that's with God. But you think some of the greatest figures in the Bible were actually homeless. John the Baptist was homeless. Paul was homeless at times. He makes mention of this in Philippians chapter 4. Jesus was most likely homeless. And even if he wasn't homeless, he wouldn't have been living in his home because he's traveling around for 3 years. He's not buying place to place, and they didn't have Airbnbs back then. He's either out there living in the wilderness, or if someone invited him, he's living in the home. So some of the greatest figures out there are actually homeless. But nonetheless, I think we can rely on God and say, hey, I have this need for a home. Can you help me with that? And I think that God does bless us with that. But even if, let's say, God didn't bless us with a home, I think it'd be insignificant in the long run. What I mean by that is this. I don't think there's a single person in hell who has said, well, I cheated and I lied and I stole my way to the top, but now I'm in hell. But hey, at least I had a good house. And I don't think there's a single person who lived the most miserable life you can imagine, who's in heaven now, who has said, I'm in heaven, but man, I wish I still had a home, even if it meant I was not here. See, I think when we get into the life that's beyond this one, those things tend to not matter. Jesus Christ, when he's talking about this, pursuing things that matter, you know, not necessarily things like homes and cars and retirement plans and things like that, but rather chasing things that bleed into the next one, like virtue and honesty and love and compassion and relationships that push both parties closer to heaven. Jesus talks about this, and he puts it like this. Don't store up your treasure on earth where moth and rust destroy, or the robber comes and steals, but lay your treasures up in heaven where the robber doesn't steal and moth and rust don't destroy. Paul said it like this. He said, we're all running in a race, striving to be the best, fighting for a crown no matter the cost, but they chasing a perishable crown. But we chase an imperishable crown. At every trailhead of our life, we have to make a decision. Even if we sit still and refuse to choose left or right, up and down, we have sat back and said, this is my choice. My choice is not to make a choice. And when you choose not to make a choice, you're still making a choice. You can't get away from it. And there's some people, and you know how that is, they're always waiting for something else. The conditions to be just right. When our kids get older and they get out of sports, then we'll bring them to church. Well, maybe once we have a little more money, we'll start giving to the church. And the excuses can go on and on and on. But what they're really doing is saying, well, until I'm faced with better solutions, I'm not going to make a choice. But what they've done is they've actually made a choice. Even if they say they're not making a choice, they've made a choice in that moment. An illustration that kind of points towards this that you've probably heard before is the man sitting on top of his roof. A hurricane came through. The floodwaters are rising and rising and rising. He's watching this, and you know, the grass was covered, and then it was up to the window, and then it was past the window, and then it gets up to the gutter. And this whole time, you know, the first time the boat comes by, and he says, come on, quick, you know, jump in. And he says, no. I'm waiting on God to save me. And that the boat driver says, okay, whatever, and goes on. Another boat driver says, come on, get in. And he says, no, waiting on God to save me. And that boat driver goes by. And then finally, a helicopter drives by. And at this point, the water's up to his feet. He's at the highest peak of the roof. And he says, come on, get in. He says, no. I prayed that God would save me, and I have faith that he will. Well, this man drowns, and he gets to heaven. He says, God, why didn't you save me? He says, I sent you two boats and a helicopter. What do you mean, why didn't I save you? Yeah, so sometimes, even though the choices aren't what we're expecting, we still have to make the choice, and we still have to do what follows God. There are all kinds of different trailheads in life. Some of them are really happy, some of them not so much. Some trailheads are wonderful. You think of marriage and children and pursuing a new occupation. Some of them aren't so much. Some decisions we have to make or issues we're faced with aren't as joyous. Think of John the Baptist. Think of John, the man that was willing to be homeless so he could preach the gospel. The man who baptized Jesus, he knew Jesus since his birth. And it's possible he even saw or heard the Father speak at Jesus' baptism when the Holy Spirit when he comes down. Form of a dove, or as a dove. John is even noted by Jesus as being the greatest of those born among women. So Jesus says this is the greatest man who has ever lived. You would think John the Baptist wouldn't have any issues with his faith. Could you imagine if Jesus was actually alive during your time? You would think that'd be a great comfort to your faith. You think that all those doubts would go away. You would think the decisions would be a little easier because the realization is right in front of you, right? I can follow Jesus or I cannot follow Jesus. When we follow Jesus, we're not literally following Jesus in the sense that he's right in front of us, though in a spiritual way, we know he is. But they actually had that physical. They could touch him. They could see him. They could eat with him. They were there. They talked to him. They had interaction back and forth. And John finds himself in jail. Jesus is alive. He finds himself in jail. See, Herod, the tetrarch, who's the king, he had taken his brother's wife to be his own. And John's preaching something, offends Herod. Rome was such a large empire that they were afraid of people revolting. So what they do is, at any and all costs, they keep people from uprising. And so the way Herod does this is, he basically says, John, I'm not going to kill you because I'm afraid of what the people would do. But I'm going to put you in prison so that you can't keep talking about me. So he puts him in prison. And I'm sure someone out there has a better guess. But my guess is anywhere between a few months and a year, John the Baptist is sitting and prison. If you would, turn your Bibles to Matthew 11. John Satan in prison. Matthew 11, verse 2 through 6. Now when John, while in prison, heard the works of Christ, he sent word by his disciples and said to them, "Are you the expected one? Should we look for someone else?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "Go and report to John what you hear and see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor have had the gospel preached to them, and blessed is he who does not take offense at me." So John comes to this trailhead of doubt, and to some extent, every situation or big question brings you to a trailhead in your life. Do I work harder or longer and provide more for my family? Or do I make less money, not provide them the conveniences and the ease of life, but work as a father? And let me just say this, fathers, I think the tendency of men is to think that the way you supply for your family is by making life comfortable for them, making it convenient, making sure they have the 65-inch TV, air conditioning, and a camper. But I think if your family had to choose between having you or having those conveniences, I think they would choose you every time. And just remember that. So we have to make these choices. There are big questions that we ask all the time. God, where are you? Do you exist? Is Christianity true? Or am I only a Christian because I was raised to be a Christian? A famous apologist, that's just someone who studies evidence for the faith, he said this. He was in a debate with an atheist, and the atheist, they each get closing remarks, and the atheist surrenders his time. And he says to this apologist, "Have you ever doubted your faith?" And he sits back and gives this apologist the whole time. Now, what is he going to say? If he says yes, well, then the atheist has won. If he says no, he seems like he hasn't actually thought it and considered his faith. So he gets up there and he says this. He says, "Intellectually, I know that there's no way around God." In other words, up here, I know he exists. He has to. No way around it. "But in my heart, I have had times of doubt and questioning despite intellectually knowing he exists." In other words, I know that God exists, but I always don't feel like he exists. John the Baptist knew who Jesus was. Intellectually, he knew that he existed. He saw him. He was there. He heard the prophecies. He saw the miracles of Jesus. But in his heart, he was starting to question. He knew Jesus existed, but he didn't feel like he was actually there. See, doubts come when we are, a doubt that comes when we are wanting a sign from God and hope that he comes is a huge trailhead in life. Let me try to word that another way. When we are expecting something, when we're hoping for something, when we're hoping God makes a move, and we sit back and we don't see anything, it can cause a lot of doubts. It can make us wonder, even though we know that God's been faithful to us time and time again in the past, when we're in those hard situations, when our faith is pressed and we don't see God moving, we can wonder, are you truly the one who I'm looking for? Or should I be looking for someone else? It's possibly the hardest trailhead you'll ever face in your life. Wanting God to make a move because you've exhausted your resources. I told you we bought a house. What I didn't tell you is it was incredibly hard to get this house. For those of you who are always interacting with us and asking us questions about that, you knew some of the things we had to go through. First, we apply for the loan, and we had a lot of issues. We had to sell a car, and then the car took so long to sell that by the time that sold, the contract was no longer valid, so they had to re-sign, and that upped our interest rate, and the interest rate was so much higher that they said, "You have to sell your other car." Well, that's a problem when you only have two cars. We sold the one car, and the one underwriter was like, "Okay, you got it." And then the other underwriter was like, "Why'd you sell your car? And what are you going to do about a car?" And we kept having to fight this battle. And finally, we got to the point where, like, we've given you what we can give you. We've done what we can done. We have reached our limit, and you have to make it work, or we'll look for another house. And there's a lot of times in our life that are even more significant. You can think of the health of a loved one. You could think about your own spiritual life, and maybe if you're looking for a church, however that goes, you say, God, I've tried it all. I've gone where I've thought I can think to go. I've listened to my friends. I've heard the advice. I've read through the Bible. I've done everything I can think to do, but I still have no clue. I still don't see any progress coming along. And that can be incredibly challenging to your faith. And I think that's where John the Baptist found himself. He said, sitting here, I've preached the truth. I've been faithful. I even baptized your son. And now I'm still rotting away in a jail all by myself. God, where are you? And we all can wonder where God is in all sorts of times. But there are a few things that I want to encourage you to do when you go through doubts, when you have to make those big decisions, when you find yourself at a trailhead and you have no clue which way to take. The first thing is to look at your surroundings. Just because the world is out of control doesn't mean you have to be. One of the fruits of the Spirit is self-control. You won't always get the news you're looking for or the solutions maybe you were promised by man. But you can control yourself and how you handle them. This world being ungodly is no excuse for any of us to be. God can't use us through the chaos if we fall into it. And I'd also like to point out, scripturally, we're called to walk through the valley of the shadow of death, not to set up camp in it. The second thing is this, look up. Most trials in this life aren't as significant as we make them. The significant part isn't necessarily the trial itself, but how we actually handle it. I love talking to the older folks here, those who have gone through some incredible hardships, because what I find 9 times out of 10 is when they're telling me these stories, I can't believe that people can make it through some of the things that you guys have made it through. The losses that you've had to face or the triumphs that you've had after some awful, awful temptations. But one thing I love about hearing those stories is all the time I'm reminded of how God works, because that's when you guys will say something to the extent of, but you know what, I wouldn't trade it for the world. Or you'll be happy in times where I couldn't think of anything else but to be sad. And I've spoke to people right after the loss of someone, and actually I spoke to someone not too long ago, and they said, you know what, I'm kind of scared. I shouldn't have this much peace. And that is inspiring to me, just knowing that so many people have gone to situations where they thought there was no hope, no escape. And then you've made it to the other side and you said, you know what? I'm better off because of it. Focus on God and not the issue. The third thing is this. Choose the path that's outcome glorifies God, not the path that looks easiest. We are faced with trailheads every day and significant ones when we are least expecting it. Temptations can ruin your life can pop up just as quickly as opportunities that can save it. Choose Jesus as the deciding factor. And finally, pursue the path despite the obstacle. Have doubts? Find the answers. I guarantee you that you'll be amazed at how awesome God truly is. I remember early in my faith, I had doubts with evolution, radiometric dating, and all those things. And then as I started studying it out, it didn't hurt my faith, but actually did the opposite. By studying out the thing I was most afraid of, my faith grew. And now I have a type of faith that I can speak to anyone despite their beliefs, because I am sure of mine and why I hold to those. And hiking, just like anything, there's its own vocabulary. And Marlene knows this. Actually, Marlene was in Maine while we were in Maine. We went one whole week without a shower. Gross. Like, when you wake up, you, like, peel the sleeping bag off you. Like, it makes a... Yeah, think about that. It was disgusting. I don't know how long you went, but she was hiking for a month. I could only imagine after a few days, I was like, ooh, this backpacking thing is something else. And she did it for a month. I'm sure she took showers at rest stops. It was gross. But in hiking, there's two types of fun. There's type one fun, type two fun. Type one fun is like Niagara Falls. While you walk up it, you see the falls, you hear it, it's beautiful. There's rainbows going everywhere from the mist. And that's type one fun. The type of fun that's fun while you're having fun, and the type of fun when you look back, it was still fun. Type two fun is a little different. Type two fun is when you're crying to your mama, right? It's when you're going up Mount LeConte and you're hungry and you're tired and you rolled your ankle and you're like, I hate this. Why did we ever go to Tennessee? And that's where, that's type two fun. But then you get up there and you look at it and you're like, this is incredible. And then you think about it. And every time you think about it, though you remember the hardship, you also remember the outcome. And that's what overwhelms the experience. This life is a lot like a type 2 fun. Christianity is a type 2 fun. Despite any of the burdens you can carry, despite any of the trials you may face, as long as you follow God to the end, you will look back and be overwhelmed with the experience of joy. So are you at a difficult trailhead in your life? Big decisions with little time to make them, doubts, feeling like God isn't moving in the way you expected to, or maybe not even at all? Are you wondering if Jesus is truly the one you've been looking for, if you should look for someone else? I'd like to remind you of what Jesus said while you guys stand up. Jesus speaks to John the Baptist, who in a lot of ways is in a situation much like ours when we face trials. And this is how Jesus responds to him. He says, the blind receive sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, the poor have had the gospel preached to them, and blessed is he who does not take offense at the gospel. Jesus is truly the one that we are all looking for. And someday, we are going to go to heaven. And as long as we point to him in this life and say, you are the one I'm looking for, when we first open our eyes beyond that invisible gate, he's going to point his finger at us and says, you are the one I was waiting for. Welcome home. Christians, it is so incredibly worth it to follow Jesus. Pray with me. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the God that you are. We thank you for the gift of your Son. We thank you for the Holy Spirit in our lives that helps us during trials and allows us to grow. And even the hardest of circumstances that we can find ourselves in. We thank you for your church that surrounds us in a way that no other group on this world ever can. I ask that you be with every single person here. Those going through good times and those going through bad times. And I ask that you bless them. And you use us to bless them and watch over them and take care of them. So that someday we can all be with you in heaven. And know that you were truly the one that we needed, and it was worth following you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. I want you to know he is the one. And this morning is the time to make that decision. Sing with us if you would.
All to Jesus I surrender.
I just want to thank you guys for being here this morning, and I encourage you to come next week. And also, if you didn't, I'd encourage you to fill out a Connect card. We'll help you along the process wherever you're at, if you have questions in your faith, if you need prayer, or if you're simply just wondering about some more information on the church. I encourage you to fill that out. And I also hope you have a great week ahead of you, and I hope that you had a great Thanksgiving behind you. And we can always be thankful as Christians, right? We got a lot to be thankful for. Bow with us as we close in prayer.
Lord God, you are awesome. Dear Lord, the great creator, we just thank you for being in our lives. Dear Lord, thank you for the message this morning. My prayer would be that we all surrender more to you, dear Lord. Learn to rely on you, depend on you, give it all to you, Lord. I pray that you'd be with us this week. Keep us all safe. Until we can gather again next Lord's Day, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.